Okay, so ready to take questions. We'll start at the microphone at the left there.
Minister Gary Balrovitz from Global, you mentioned flexibility to respond to new economic developments. You've pushed back your deficit targets once. Will you do it again if you have to fund more interventions in the economy?
Well, as you know, we make our calculations and projections based on the average of the projections of the private sector economists. We made 2014-15, that fiscal year, the target in the platform, and that remains our aim when we identify the efficiencies we're seeking or have stronger economic growth. But we have to be flexible and pragmatic given the global situation, particularly in Europe.
And if I could just ask a follow-up, U.S. GDP went up in the third quarter 2.5%. Canadian GDP flatter declining. So has the bloom come off the Canadian rose, so to speak?
Well, no. I think we are seeing modest growth in Canada. That's what's anticipated by the private sector economists. 2.1% real GDP growth. And that's what we anticipate this year and next year.
Mr. Flaherty, Brett Harris from Business News Network. Just to follow up on the original question there, just looking at your charts here, if you fall even slightly short of your $4 billion cost savings program in 2015-16, it looks like you'd be back in a deficit that year again as well. How much room for error do you have? How much margin is there to meet these deficit targets if the global economy deteriorates faster than it is currently?
Well, we built in a substantial short-term risk adjustment in this budget that's quite large because of the global uncertainty. We have to be realistic about what's going on in the world. We also, in the Deficit Reduction Action Plan, have asked departments to bring forward proposals at 5% and 10%. So there may be room for more efficiencies there as necessary as we go forward.
If required, if the economy does deteriorate faster than it is now, would you simply just push out that target, that deficit reduction target, another year?
Listen, we make the assumptions based on the projections of the private sector economists. I'm confident that we're going to continue to have modest growth. We discount the recommendations of the private sector economists, and then especially this year, a very significant short-term adjustment for risk. So I'm satisfied that our planning is prudent.
Well, left.
Minister Flaherty, Aaron Collins with CBC National News. You mentioned that $600 million that's going to be left in the hands of businesses and workers by continuing to cap the increases on EI. One would think that the hope is that money then gets circulated through the economy. And I'm just wondering how confident you are, given the sort of instability out there, that money's going to get circulated.
Yeah, our job creation numbers overall are good. You know, about 600,000 net new jobs since the end of the recession, July 2009. People working are contributing to EI, and their employers are. This is a direct break of $600 million in 2012. I expect we'll see it acting in the economy quickly.
Just if I have a quick follow-up, we're standing across from a pretty big building project here in Calgary, and you know, we're hearing from construction companies that a lot of the projects are still, you know, relying on that federal stimulus money. And I'm wondering, given sort of the downturn here, can we expect some more money coming through as far as stimulus spending?
Well, we still have the Canada Infrastructure Fund that continues. It's not as if we're not spending any money on infrastructure. And, of course, we have the initiative with respect to public-private partnerships, which creates P3 Canada Inc., which creates more infrastructure opportunities across the country. We have some major building plans, for example, shipbuilding, that is a massive long-term job generator across the country. It isn't just Nova Scotia and Atlantic Canada and the West Coast. It affects the entire country because of all the suppliers.
But nothing new planned is in the near future?
No, we're going to continue as we were. We're spending a lot of money on infrastructure, as I say, and we're going to continue that. But the whole purpose of the Economic Action Plan was to provide a protection, a temporary protection. If we were to continue with that plan now, we would create a structural deficit in Canada. We'd end up in the same kind of mess, quite frankly, that some other countries in the world have gotten themselves into, and we're not going there.
Okay.
Nathan Vanderclip with the Globe and Mail. Your officials and your projections are assuming that federal health transfer payments will continue to increase at 6% a year on, all the way through to 2016-2017. Should the provinces count on that money, or are you considering reducing that rate of growth once the current transfer deal expires?
Well, the commitment is 2 years beyond the current transaction at the current accord. At 6% with respect to Canada Health Transfer. For planning purposes, we run it out throughout the project period at 6%, but that has to be seen in the context of the discussions that will take place.
And was there some tipping point? Was there some moment that sort of caused you to decide that you would have to push back your deficit target there?
You know, I'd like to be frank with you, I mean, we look at the projections, we look at the numbers, we don't fudge the numbers, and we don't try to artificially create a surplus. The numbers work out that we, as you see, it's on page 14 of the document, you see that we have a relatively small, given the size of the budget, deficit in 2014-15. Things may change. We may have more efficiencies. We may save more money deficit reduction action plan. That may work to save more money. We may have stronger economic growth than anticipated. But we use the numbers that we're given and we follow them through, and right now that shows us running into a surplus in 2015-16.
No left.
Follow-up to that, Joan Crockett from Crockett Communications. I know this is a difficult balancing act when you're trying to figure out how much the economy is going to grow, but the people in there went away with the message that you were sticking to your target, whereas when we actually look at the fine print, we see that there is a deficit, taking us through until 2015. And I'm wondering, what message do you really want to leave Canadians with, that we are going to balance in 2014, or we're going to have to wait till 2015, and what probability would you give for being able to reach the target still in 2014?
Well, I'm certainly satisfied that we'll balance the budget in the medium term, which is what I'm saying. I think anyone who's been paying attention would see the projections by the private sector economists, which were released a few weeks ago, and see that our real GDP growth this year and next will be off about 0.7%, according to them, which of course reduces revenue. So you just have to follow that track out as we go forward. And as I say, we don't fudge the numbers. These are the real numbers. I'm confident that we will balance the budget in the medium term. I hope we will continue to aim at 2014-15. And see if we can manage that. Otherwise, the following year.
Can you give it a probability?
No, I can't. I mean, we're living in a highly uncertain world, and that's why we've built in, as I said earlier, a large risk adjustment in this budget, particularly in the near term, because that's where the greatest global uncertainty is.
Okay.